Good morning, students. This is your science teacher, and we are there in the continuation of your lesson 3, Is Matter Pure? Before entering into today's topic, let's recapitulate the previous class. In the last class, we have learned about mixtures, types of mixtures, and about homogeneous and heterogeneous mixtures. All these we have learned. I hope you have studied your textbook, children. And here is a continuation of the lesson. With today's topics, solutions, what are the properties of solutions, what is meant by concentration of a solution, how to prepare the saturated and unsaturated solutions, what are the factors affecting the rate of dissolving. All these contents today we will see, children. Here I will come up with a slide. What is this, children? This is a lemonade. And in the previous class, we have seen the explanation of this, isn't it? Here, this is made up of sugar, salt, water, and lemon juice. This is which type of mixture, children? This is a homogeneous mixture. That is the thing which we have learned in the last class. Why it is called homogeneous? Why it is called homogeneous mixture? It is called as a homogeneous mixture. Why? Because you are unable to differentiate the components with your naked eye. Whatever you have mixed there, either water or sugar or a pinch of salt or the lemon, you are unable to. They have been dissolved in it completely. That's why it is called as a homogeneous mixture. That is the thing which we have learned. Here is a one more slide showing you an example of soda water. Can you separate the soda from that? That means here what is happening is a gas is getting dissolved in the water and you are calling it as a soda water. Are we able to separate that? No, we are unable to. That's why this is also called as a homogeneous mixture. Isn't or not, children? Here, the homogeneous mixture, which is made up of two or more substances, and if we are unable to separate its components by a process of filtration, then it is said to be a solution. Did you understand, children? This homogeneous mixture, it is made up of two or more, isn't or not? And these two or more components, whatever have been combined, and if you are unable to separate them by the process called as filtration, then such solutions or such homogeneous mixtures are said to be solutions. Did you understand, children? Yes. Here I come up with a slide. A beaker is there, in that some water is there, and I am adding a spoon of salt for it, and I am stirring it to make it to dissolve. This is called as a salt solution. Here the solution can be in the form of solids, liquids, and gases. Generally, in a solution, it contains two components. One is said to be solvent and one is said to be solute. Here, this is called as a salt solution. Is it or not, children? Then, which is said to be solvent and which is said to be solute, we will see. Here, the component of the solution that dissolves another component in it. Here, which is dissolving something in it? The salt is getting dissolved in water. That means this is a component of the solution where it is making the salt to dissolve in it. That's why this is said to be the solvent. And the substance which is getting dissolved in it is said to be the solute. Did you understand, children? The two components which are present there in the solution are, one will make the another substance to get dissolved in it, that is said to be the solvent. And the component of solution that is dissolved in the solvent is said to be the solute. Like this, two components will be there. A solution of a sugar or salt is prepared by dissolving the sugar or salt in the water. In this, the solid, either sugar or salt, whatever you are taking there, is called as a solute, because very small quantity you will be taking there. And water, which is there in a liquid state, is said to be a solvent. And this solvent is in a very large quantity. Even one more example is, in the solution of iodine in alcohol, that means here in this, iodine is a solute, a small content, and alcohol is a solvent. In each and every solution, both the components will be there. One is a solvent and one is a solute. And in all the aerated drinks or liquid solutions, they will be containing the carbon dioxide gas in it, and which you can't separate them. And here the carbon dioxide gas is said to be the solute, and where it is getting dissolved in the water, that is called as a solvent. Like this, each and every solution will be having two components. One is the solvent and one is the solute. Yes, see here children, think that this is the water or some other thing. That means the component which is making some other thing to get dissolved in it, and the component which is getting dissolved in one more is said to be the solute. Like this, always a solution is formed by the adding of two. One must be the solvent and one more must be the solute. Once you add this, you will be getting a solution. Did you understand, children? We will go for the next part. What are the properties of this solution? Generally, in the solution, the particles will be very small. We can't see them with our naked eyes. One of the property will be the size of the particles. Why? Because they will be very small, and we will not be able to differentiate them once they get dissolved in the solvent. That's why the first property is the size of the particles are very small. The second property, as they can't scatter a beam of light through them, as they don't scatter the beam of light through them, these and hence the path of the light is not visible in the solutions. That means these particles are very small in such a way, if you take a glass of water with the salt dissolved in it, and if you make some light rays to pass through them, that light cannot be scattered there. That's why you will not be able to have the visibility of the light in the solutions. Did you understand, children? That means into the in depth of this particular lesson, you will be getting this content when you will be calling this as a scattering beam, and when you will be calling this non-scattering beam. That means in the some of the solutions will be there where light, if you allow the light to pass through it, it will scatter the rays. It will scatter the particles what are present in it. But in few solutions, they will not be scattered. Those are called as the homogeneous solutions. And the third point is the solute particles does not settle down when left undisturbed. Once take a glass of water and mix some spoon of salt in it and make it to stir in the water and get it dissolved, and leave it on the table for 5 to 10 minutes without disturbing it. Can you see any settling down of the salt content, whatever you have taken? No. You will not be able to see this. Why? Because these have been dissolved in the water. You can't separate them. That's why this is called as a homogeneous solutions. That's why the third property of the solution is the solute particles does not settle down when they have been left undisturbed. These are the three properties of the solutions, children. Coming to the solutions, here I have told you the solute will be there which will be dissolving in a solvent. Is it or not? When you can call it as a solubility, the amount of solute which is present in a saturated solution at a certain temperature is said to be the solubility. That means solubility means at a particular temperature, how much of amount of solute the solvent is taking. That is said to be the saturated solution, and that solute is said to be the solubility, you will be calling it as. And what are these saturated or unsaturated solutions? We will see now. Simple examples we will go with, children. I have taken some 50 ml of water and I have added a spoon of sugar to it, or think salt, sugar or salt, whatever it is. Salt I will take here. I have added a spoon of salt to it. Then I will stir it. It will be getting dissolved. Again, one more spoon of salt I will add to it. And again, I will stir it. Again, it will get dissolved. One more spoon I will add it. Like this, I will continue the process until if I add some more salt to it, it will not be able to dissolve it. Then that particular solution, that means no more solute it will be able to take. The solvent will not be able to take no more solute. That particular stage is said to be saturated. That means if I take a glass of water and if I give 2 spoons of salt in it, that is said to be an unsaturated. That means still more it can take 2 to 3 spoons of salt. If I go on adding, it is having that capacity to make it to dissolve in it. But up to which point, after some 5 to 6 spoons, it will not be able to make to dissolve. That particular stage, that solution is said to be the saturated solutions. And if you are not taking up to that particular stage, that is said to be unsaturated. Simply taking a glass of water, adding a spoon of sugar or salt to it and making it to dissolve, that is unsaturated. That means still more it can take the solute particles into it. That condition is said to be the unsaturated. Here, through the slides, we have defined it when no more solute can be dissolved. That particular solution is said to be saturated. See here, saturated, solute and solvent completely. In the bottom, if you see, excess of solute is there. If you are stirring also, it is not getting dissolved in this. This particular solution is said to be the saturated solution. And unsaturated also, I have told you, no, that solvent is having still more capability of dissolving the solute in it. That is said to be the unsaturated. For that, the definition is there. You read it once, children. Yes. Here is a picture showing you the unsaturated and saturated. These are not there in your textbook, children. I have gathered it from somewhere else. Here, it clearly shows you unsaturated and saturated solutions. See here, think I have taken some 5 to 6 spoons of salt into it and I am able to dissolve. That means these are all the solute particles. These many gaps are there in the solvent which is having that capability to make it to dissolve. And still more, if you go on adding, it will not be able to. As I have shown you a picture now here. Let us go for the picture. See here, still more if you add, it have been remained back. That particular solutions are said to be saturated. Still where this is not getting dissolved. See here, through the picture we came to know, if only less particles, less solute particles if you are adding, then still more capability it is having to make the solute dissolve in it. That type of solutions are said to be the unsaturated solutions. And where it have been sufficiently given and no more solute can be added to the solvent, that type of solutions are said to be the saturated solutions. But this saturated solutions, as I have told you, at last the solute is getting remained back. That can also be to make it to dissolve by increasing its temperature. That means by heating it. If you make it to heat, then you will be able to make the solute to dissolve in it. And still more solute also you can add it. Those type of solutions are said to be super saturated solutions. But they will be very unstable. That's why he did not describe you in your textbook, children. Okay, once the school opens again, we will recapitulate all the lessons. At that time, I will tell for you. Next topic is, what are the factors which will affect the rate of dissolving? Temperature, size of the solute particles and stirring. Here, I will give you a small example. Take a glass of water. In that, take 1 spoon of sugar and leave it undisturbed. Don't stir it. Just leave it undisturbed on the table for some time. After 5 to 10 minutes, if you see the sugar or the salt, whatever you have added, no, it will be there itself. It don't get dissolved. Why? Because without stirring, it won't get dissolved. That's why this is also a factor. And one more is, sugar crystals, if you are buying, maybe in your home, you will be seeing sometimes very fine sugar will be there. Sometimes the sugar crystals will be very big in size. And these two, the fine crystals will be dissolving very fast. And the crystals which are having a very big size will be dissolving very slowly. That means depending upon the size of solute particles also, this dissolving will be affected. and even the temperature, as I have told you, in the saturated solutions you will be leaving the solute down. At that time also you can make it an super saturated solution by heating it. That means by heating you can make it to dissolve in it. Not only that spoon of sugar or salt, but you can add few more spoons of sugar or salt to the solutions. That means through the temperature also you will be able to dissolve the solute in the solvent. That's why these are the three factors which will affect the rate of dissolving of the solution. Next content is, what is meant by concentration and what is meant by dilute? Here, this is a definition which is showing you children. I don't read this definition here in this. I will tell you a small example. Take 2 glasses of water. Take 2 glasses of water and add 2 spoons of salt to one of the glass and 4 to 5 spoons of salt to one of the glass. Again, I am repeating, take 2 glasses of water and for the first glass, you add 2 spoons of salt or sugar. It's your wish, children. And for the second one also, the same whatever you are solute adding to the first one, the same thing you have to add. But for the second glass, take double or triple of the salt or sugar you are adding. Then, the solution where you have taken the solute very less, that type of solution is said to be dilute solutions. And where the solute you are taking more, 4 to 5 or 5 to 6 spoons of solute you are taking in a solvent, that is said to be the concentration or concentrated solutions. Did you get the difference in between these two, children? That means in a dilute solution, the amount of this solute will be very less. But in a concentrated, the amount of solute present will be very high. I think so you have understood the lesson, children. And read your textbook. Hardly 1.5 pages only is getting completed, children, for each and every class. That's why whenever the class is getting completed on the same day itself, you read your textbooks. And go on with your assignment. In the next slide, assignment is there. Go on with this assignment and write it in the homework book. Thank you. Take care, Nana. Bye.